Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. So I think all of you are here today because we try to navigate the complexities of product management that require more than just technical or knowledge expertise. It demands effective collaboration, trust building, and working with cross-functional teams on a daily basis. You cannot imagine, and I think all of us know how we work on a daily basis with multiple teams. Today, we are fortunate to have with us three seasoned product leaders who will share their insights and strategies from building strong relationships, creating cohesive teams aligned towards the same goal. This is the most challenging part on product management. Our discussion today will cover essential topics such as building collaborative culture, overcoming the barriers to trust, which is very hard to build in the beginning. And by the time you gain this, you have to practically advise for, also we need to practically advise for the new leaders. We will be hearing real world examples and success stories and also challenging stories that highlight the importance of building trust, collaborating and achieving product excellence. Let me dive deep directly and to know more about our panelists and explore how to build trust and collaborate effectively with two disclaimers. Each panelist here represents their own views and not their own companies. And also, I would really encourage everyone to post your questions in the chat, and we will try to get through some of these if we have the time left. With that, I go to Michael.
Hello, everyone. I'm so happy to be here with you. My name is Michael Shafik. I've been in the technology industry for more than 18 years, building my own company, working for companies like Meta and Tesla and Schneider Electric for more than 18 years now. Happy to be here. Jaqueline.
Yeah. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Prateek. I'm a senior product leader at Amazon. I have over 10 years of experience in product management. I've worked with companies like Ford in the past, and looking forward to this amazing panel.
Hi, everyone. Jaqueline here. I'm currently working as a group product manager in Delivery Hero, but also in the last 10 years, I've been working in product, leading cross-functional teams from small startups to big companies, and very happy to be here also discussing a topic that I like a lot.
Super. Thank you all. And I am a senior product director in Delivery Hero, working with Jaqueline, but in a different department, focusing on quick commerce. I think with the people we see and the panelists we have in the room, we have a decade of experiences. And I think everyone listening to this chat today, they will be really looking into understanding the topic end to end. So let me start from the beginning, like the introduction of the importance of trust and collaboration. So maybe I start with you, Prateek, from Amazon, from your perspective, actually. Why is building trust important for any product organization?
I think trust is crucial for any organization because product is very crucial to a company. And I believe in capitalist economy, companies exist to maximize shareholder value. The way they do that is making sure that they have differentiation in the market consistently over long periods of time. Now, how can that happen is when your product and your stakeholders within the team have high trust, that's how they'll be able to differentiate themselves from the market for the long time. So I believe trust does happen between stakeholders within the organization, outside of the organization, and all that bleeds into shareholder trusting the stock and investing in it. So I think it is that crucial to have trust within and outside of the organization. Within, you can bifurcate into within the teams, sister teams, and different skill sets. But I think in a nutshell, that is how I foresee trust being very crucial for a company.
Super. And do you see that like it has to start from inside first, right? Within the organization, and it reflects outside. If that's what you are trying to say, right?
Yeah, I think as the product organization, we are responsible for the thought leadership within the organization and outside it is portrayed to the customer, right? So within a company, a product leader should definitely create mechanisms in which honest conversations are part and parcel of everyday's life. I see there are like two aspects of building trust. Number one is empathizing with any stakeholders that you're working with, so understanding where they're coming from. And secondly, I also build trust when I'm able to see a competent person across the team. So when I believe that they're competent and they're able to empathize me and vice versa, I think that's a very good recipe to build trust right off the bat.
Absolutely makes sense. And with that, let me go to the different level where, yes, so we all understand now the importance of trust inside and outside in order to build this collaborative culture, because also trust depends on the how we collaborate together. How can we create or promote this culture and foster this collaboration within the any product organization? Michael, do you see it from your perspective?
Hi, Wafaey. Thank you so much for this question. Trust and collaboration goes hand by hand. Like, you cannot put one without the other. So I'll split my answer into two sections. One, let's actually understand what is collaboration, and from there we'll talk about the building blocks of what makes a collaborative culture. So by definition, collaboration is to work jointly with others to accomplish a specific task. So that in itself, like, has different elements. One of them is myself, one of them is others I'm collaborating with. The third is a task that we're trying to accomplish, and the lastly is the methodology or channels or the way we communicate with each other to achieve that collaboration for that task. I will leave the task piece and the communication piece for a different discussion, but I will focus on the two major human elements of collaboration, which is myself and others. To be in a collaborative culture or to create a collaborative culture, I have to ask like deep introspective questions to be able to get to the level that I want to be. So if I'm asking myself is like, how, few questions just to intrigue the people around here, like, how can I make it safe for others to trust me or to collaborate with me? Like, I wanna come across as someone who is collaborative, friendly, trustworthy, and so how can I do that? Another question would be like, how could we all win? Like, when we collaborate, sometimes I've seen it in different cultures when people want to collaborate, quote unquote, and then they work in a project. And one of the people or a few of the people is like, I am in it for myself. I'm not in it for the team. And that's actually one of the biggest hurdles, I would say, which we'll talk about later on. So deep questions for myself of like, what type of personality or what type of behaviors do I need to portray to others that's important? The second piece is like, others, let me put myself in others' shoe. Like, if someone says to me like, hey, Michael, I want to collaborate with you on such and such project, why would they want to collaborate with me? What is it in them, for them, that would help them to collaborate with me? If I'm able to answer these questions, I think that would help me. And I would say if I put it like, it's an introspective and empathy for others that would help in that. Let's move to the second phase, and I hope I'm not taking too much long. Wafaey, please hold me accountable for the time. Yeah.
Very interesting topic. No.
Thank you. The building blocks for collaboration is the foundation. Trust is the foundation that we're talking about. But there is also more elements that we develop as we grow in our careers, which is like autonomy, which helps in the ownership. If I have autonomy, if I'm telling everyone like what to do in a product, I'm not giving them space to grow, to take ownership, or to have autonomy to be creative and innovative. And that kills trust by itself, right? Communication and transparency. How do I communicate transparently with all the people in the same time respectfully with every one of them? Open feedback is a huge building block for this. How can I create the safety space so that we can have feedback for each other in a very respectful way without no judgment to help foster the culture? And part of that open feedback is conflict resolution. How could I have these elements of conflict resolution to help work with these others? It would be a little bit naive if we say like, hey, we're a group of people from different cultures, different backgrounds, different identities and ideas, and work together and everything is gonna go smooth. Things would happen, conflict would arise. conflict is not a bad thing, but the main thing is, how am I addressing this conflict? How am I making it safe for others to address conflict with me as well? How could I make it where everyone really shares a win? A lot of people say, like, hey, we need to share the win. The win is for everyone. But how do you really actually do that? So I will end my thoughts with three different things. If you basically have the deep introspective to have clarity in mind by what is your true motive for collaborating with others, having the empathy for your peers and customers to understand where are they coming from and read their emotions and fears, and then having these tools, six different elements that I just talked about. I would love to leave this question with a last comment. Is one is too small of a number to achieve greatness. This is a quote by one of my great mentors. His name is John Maxwell. You can search him out. But if you really want to grow in your career, you cannot do it by yourself. You definitely can achieve things by yourself, but it's going to always be small. If you want to achieve greatness and bigger things, you have to collaborate with others. Sorry if I took too much time, Wafaey.
No, super. I think it's very interesting, especially when you touched the point of transparency, open feedback. And I think this is all not related to the expertise of a product manager. It's all about the skill set, how you communicate and how you receive also all kinds of communication. Because we will never work with people who are just in a very, I usually name it the honeymoon phase, where you get everyone is really happy and all the stuff. No, every day we have challenges at work and we need to deal with that on a daily basis. So I think everyone in the room today, listening to what you said, Prateek and Michael, will think about how can I see real examples, best practices, and also handling the challenges. So as I said, the honeymoon is not every day, right? We have periods where it's really tough. We need to deal with it. So Jaqueline, if you can mention from your expertise and your experience some difficult situations where there is no trust or collaboration between members and how you can handle that.
For sure. I think Michael mentioned some keywords that I trust a lot as well, that are the starting point. And for me, communication, transparency, and connection between the group, between the team is essential. When we talk about difficult situations, and then I can mention some, like when we have issues, when we launch a product, or when your product is not working as expected, or the team went through a layoff, many situations where we face ups and downs, motivation is in risk, right? And then we can face both these, like, lack of commitment between the group, lack of trust, lack of collaboration, and many other examples. Maybe two members that don't interact very well, there is a competitive environment. Any root cause, for me, the way we move forward and the way where we usually have success, first understanding when we join this team, when we start connecting with these members, right? Values and what motivates them to be there. Like, why I'm here, why I'm in this company, in this role, what is my mission and what I like to do, what I don't like to do. A bit of sharing vulnerabilities, you know, getting connected with each member. And as a product leader, leading a team there, understanding how each one will behave, their own needs and way of working to drive the ways of working of the group. So I faced some examples where this empathy with different backgrounds, in a global environment. We have different approaches also when handling situations. And it's important to have this connection, right? The empathy with the other, depending on the moment of their, like, personal life or career, more junior members or more senior members, adapting communication and the ways of working so everyone will be on the same page. Also, two important tools when you talk about feedback, essential, the in two way, right? Sharing and giving feedback always in a good example of a nice initiative that we did or something that we need to improve. So making sure we have that and using retros. For me, the retro, when you do every sprint or monthly, is a powerful tool to build trust between the team, you know, where sometimes anonymous or we can share how we want, like providing also, this is my post-it. This helps in another week, in another sprint, to have a very different environment. So sometimes we are in a busy week, in a busy reality, we don't do, but I enforce, like, it's super, super helpful to create this environment. So as product leaders, I see lots of importance also in using this tool. Hope I answered the question.
Yes, and maybe a question from myself is talking about, okay, when you talk about retrospectives, we have to talk about cross-collaborated teams, right? So it is not your, like, a PM who is working on daily basis with his engineers, but you talk about stakeholders, you talk about people coming from different organizations and so on. Do you see that this is also a good, effective way to do this kind of retrospectives beyond your focus or your engineering teams?
For sure, at least on a quarterly base, you know, when we have long iteration, we have something to discuss and plan the future. We eventually don't need to do bi-weekly or in every sprint with everyone, but depending on the milestone, what we achieved or what we want to achieve next, maybe we are changing completely the strategy, so we need to collect feedback, how things are going. It's super powerful. It's difficult sometimes for the ones who are now working in a cross-functional team to understand a bit on the how we should do it, but when they get in the culture and this will become a habit, right? It's super useful also to get everyone in the same page. A bit of what we said, right? This will create this environment of trust, but also will drive us to higher impact. All the benefits of having the foundation of trust on everyone. Right?
Thank you. Very valid. So we have seen from Jaqueline, like, the challenging situations and from a real world example. Let me move to you, Prateek, and ask a quick question on the best practices and the success stories. Where do you see actually a good example of building trust internally or externally, as you started at the beginning?
Sure. I think I have seen a recent example, and I'm a big believer in, like, looking at really great leaders and learning from them. So recently I learned this from Sarah Harvey at Amazon. She inherited a very complex and big charter. The reason it was complex is because the team was not in good shape. There was a lot of attrition. There was the charter was almost lost. We didn't know. We were not able to make positive ROI. A lot of things was inherited by her. What I see from her, she did a couple of things. Number one was she actually brought clarity to the whole organization by clearly defining what she's looking for from this organization. So clearly defining the goals. Secondly, she had set up multiple fireside chats with different cohorts in the organization to show how her mental model works when she tries to reach a decision. Thereby, people can replicate it and understand if we follow this particular route, we'll be aligned with the leader itself. And the third piece was, again, reaffirming the fact that we are an organization where we want to build people's careers. So how that building careers is attached to the goals that you are driving. So getting clarity in these three aspects, I've seen the whole organization rallying behind her, and I've taken some really good pointers from it whenever that situation comes to me. So apart from that, I believe, like, if I give an example, there is a really good book called Humans. The first time when humans started to build walls, it was because within the walls, they understood that we want security and food, and we need to save ourselves from outside encroachers or animals. So when you know you have something in common that you're working towards, and when you know that what you want to shield yourself from, if that becomes clear between a group of people, the trust arises between them. So I believe that is still true to this day and age. And I believe as a team tries to identify both these aspects, the trust naturally flows in.
Okay, very interesting example on how it will work. I would go with a question also coming from the group here on how to manage the engagement of the people involved. I think it's connected to what you are saying, Prateek. And maybe I can go now to the barriers, actually. And I think you touched, Prateek, in your examples, the good ones, and also the difficult one from Jaqueline. Now, for you, Michael, a question comes to the group, is that how we connect the dots, how we bring people to on the same page. One of the major barriers, what I see also from the questions, very perfect question, by the way, is building trust among cross-functional teams is the challenge. Actually, you have individual interest, you have interest also for your ROI, as Prateek was giving examples. I have my interest for my performance as a product or even a different stakeholder with a different role. So all of these are barriers for building this trust. What is your takeaway on this?
Sure. Let me ask a question to the audience, if I can take a second or two to do that. Like, what do you guys think, since we're all about collaboration and trust, by the way, so what do you guys think would be the major barriers internally and externally to building trust? Hope we can get a couple here. I also like the question and comments here. Let me go, like, from my own personal perspective, people need two main things. They need safety and they need respect. And when safety and respect is not there, it is really hard for them to trust anyone. So communication. So I thank you so much, guys. I see communication. I see overlap, which is good. Rules are undefined. Yes. These are all good things. And as I said, like, the two main things that people usually need is safety and respect. To build safety and respect, we need to see the people behind the employee, what they need. Most probably to build that, to manage that engagement and get people involved, try to understand first what they want. What they want out to get out of this project. What they want to get out of this project could be totally different from what I want to get out of it could be different. I don't think necessarily overlap is an overlap. I think usually when we get to a milestone, even though there is like different aims, like I want to get recognition, I want to get promotion, someone else wants to learn, someone wants to just achieve, like we need to get an ROI. Those are not necessarily overlapping if you clearly communicate what you want and acknowledge that people want that. And then in the winning piece of it, acknowledge the small wins and give the people what they want. They will give you what they want and what you want in return. And it's not like a give and take piece, although we as humans, we think that way. Like, what am I going to get out of this naturally? So if you're willing actually to get out of yourself and give first, and I would say take the initiative to trust. Fulfill your promises. Make even if it's a small promise, fulfill your promise. Acknowledge the small wins. All of these elements helps in building that. And it does not come on a day. Like, it actually takes time to build that rapport in front of people to see you actually fulfilling what you're saying. You're full going through what you're saying. How you also like react when someone mistrusts you or like accuses you of something. Are you gonna be merciful and kind to them and trying to understand why they did this, or you're just giving it a judgment and it's like, hey, I don't want to work with you anymore? I think understanding the people behind the employee is a key element of building that safety net, which builds on the respect afterwards. So respect and understanding of others. Hopefully that answers your question.
Michael,
yes, go ahead, exactly. Yeah.
Sorry, just wanted to compliment. I feel that we have also a challenge that is promoting that across the team, right? Because sometimes we have this like connection between the other. We know who is the other person, but who is there, like what are the motivations of the person, but the others, they don't know. So by the moment we get a safe environment and we have this connection across the team, is the key change I feel that we need to promote, right?
Yep, and I think I'll take one of the things which is on the comment itself, the lack of commitment from stakeholders. So at times I've had my team come to me like, hey, I've been trying to engage with them and I'm not getting any luck. So I start asking them some questions like, hey, like, how much do we know about their charter? How much do we know about their processes? How much do we know about the things that they care about? And often the devil lies in that details, because if we don't know them, it'll be very hard to encourage or motivate them for your cause. So when you're able to connect your cause to their cause or ROI, or even as simple as talking in the terms that they talk within the team, when we do these small things, I've seen that people from lack of commitment, they get engaged to the least. And when they get engaged, you can soothe them into understanding how it is important for the customer, what is the impact that you're driving, and what are the benefits that their team can get out of it. And it depends on which team you're talking about, data team, software teams, program team, business team, sales team. So communicating the project that you have for them, how it impacts to them, also impacts the commitment that they have with your team.
Super. And I think very valid cases from your side. I think every one of you have seen different experience in different organizations, right? And I think this is where I will come to you, Jaqueline, and ask you a question which is touching the comments we see in the panel here, which also Prateek touched on, lack of commitments in politics, and or, because we cannot isolate it. This is reality, right? Politics is everywhere. It especially comes with the big organization. It also comes with the burden of pressure of even if you're working in a startup, right? So what is the best advice that you can give to new product leaders who are, or young leaders who are just joining a new position or coming to a new organization, and you need to build the trust from scratch? As I usually say, that building trust is very hard, losing it is very easy, right? So what is your guidance there?
I feel that mostly nowadays, and when we think on joining a new team, we need to be kind of a shelf or a bubble also for the team, kind of protecting from external interventions or any situation that as a leader will be handling, but bringing still the motivation high, you know, driving for goals, driving for impact, keeping the energy in the good mood. We have this challenge due to any situations that will happen during from Monday to Friday in our calendar, right? So for me, this is the first key attitude when you think on protecting the team, right? And making sure we are still there on this good energy. Second, thinking on some years ago when I joined as in my first product position, product leader position, I read a book, Five Dysfunctions of a Team. It's very connected to everything we discussed today. And it helped me a lot also to make the others there understand a bit on the book. And then they also read, it was something that everyone was in the same page on the foundation of trust, everything we are talking here. And we did the exercise. So thinking on opening for the team, for the group, what I do well, what I don't do well, what I need help, where you can support me, promoting this safe environment and getting the connection between each others. For me, it's a good starting point. Of course, you have your one-on-ones as a manager, you have career discussions, feedback. But beyond that, promoting the safe environment between the group and the collaboration, this is something that can help a lot also on having a good start. At least we'll know behind what we have as values, goals, what I like to do, what I don't like to do, how we can help each other, and then with our talents, move forward, right? So I would share those two points of attention as something super important.
Thank you. Maybe before we close the panel, I would need 30 seconds from you, Michael and Prateek, to tell me one advice from your end for all young leaders.
I can go first. So I think anyone who is new joining product management community, the first thing I usually tell people who I'm mentoring is you need to be self-aware of your strengths and weaknesses, because unless you know them, you'll not be able to work on them. Let's take a topic around politics. Politics usually becomes hard for people who are not very good in communicating and getting their point across. So what I try to do with them is that, hey, like there is a, I would say, a saying in Japanese called nemawashi. If you want to get an alignment from a broader group of people and you want to have less, politics in between, you try to get people aligned one by one and then put it in front of them as a cohort. So like some tips and tricks are already there, but the most important thing I would say is being self-aware of your strengths and weaknesses so that you can work on it. And it's a journey. I think we all are in that journey. As we go above and as we go in different organizations, different challenges would arise. So you should always be ready to, you know, learn and, you know, learn new things, unlearn some things, and be open to that.
Thank you. Michael, we'll end this with you.
I would say that we're all product managers in progress. Like none of us like is a complete work, right? So know that you will always learn. There's something that there is out there that you need to learn. So, and the key feedback I would say to everyone, seek feedback. Seek feedback. And don't take feedback in a negative lens by any means, because like if you go and ask your manager, your peers, like, how am I doing this? Some people are afraid to ask that question, thinking that people would see them as incompetent. But actually, that actually shows that you want to improve. You want to learn. You want to know like what is your strengths and weaknesses, which go to Partek's question. Like how would you know? Sometimes you know and sometimes you don't. And if you don't seek that feedback and work on the elements, and if you found like a consistent theme between different people, that means like that's something that I need to work on. And the second thing is like, doesn't matter what culture you're in. If you actually do the right things, even in a tough culture, you will win. People will see that. It might not be like in a day, but over the long term, it will definitely show up.
Perfect. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Very interesting discussion. I think we can have hours and hours discussing this and sharing our expertise. Thank you to our incredible panelists for sharing your valuable insights and experiences today. It's clear building trust and collaboration is not something easy. It's a crucial element to succeed as a product manager and as also your team to save, for the safeness of your team. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you also. See you all soon.
Thanks, Wafaey, and thank you, everyone, for joining us. We're happy to be here. Bye-bye.